Well, good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to St. John's United Church of Christ, where no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome in this safe and sacred space. As we gather together this morning, I would like to say happy Father's Day to all of our fathers amongst us. But also a reminder that as today is a joyous day and we give thanks for the wonderful fathers in our lives, there are many who this is a troubling day. So for those whose fathers have not been present, those whose fathers were not a good father, for those who have lost their fathers and are missing them, for the fathers, for the men who desire to be fathers and are not yet, we remember them and our prayers are with them as we give thanks for all of the men in our lives who have been father figures to us. So we thank the men who are here for being wonderful examples and caring and loving figures in our lives. So thank you, men. Today is the last day to RSVP for the church picnic that the church is hosting next Sunday. So make sure you can sign up on the sheet out in the narthex. You can register online, all kinds of different ways to RSVP. But let us know because the church is providing the food and dessert. So make sure to sign up and mark your calendars to stay, and we will dine and eat and celebrate together next Sunday after worship. Today, right after worship is over, I am heading out to Camp Movale, and I will be a shepherd at Camp Movale this next week with children ages 8 to 15, and the counselors who are ages 16 to early 20s. So I ask your prayers for me for this coming week. Patience and energy and wisdom. So next Sunday, we will be welcoming a guest preacher who will be with us so I can focus on the kids and camp this week. So I ask for your prayers, and I am excited about next Sunday. Our picnic and a guest preacher. As we gather together, we remember that we gather as the body of Christ, not just as St. John's, but as the whole body of Christ. And so let us extend a warm welcome and a peace of Christ to one another. And also with you.
Over and around.
For the joy of human love, brother, sister, parent, child, friends on earth and friends above, for all gentle thoughts and mild, for all gentle thoughts and mild.
Morning, and thank you, Meher, for sharing your wonderful voice with us. If you're able, please rise and join in the call to worship. I will lead the light print, and you can follow in the bold. God is the sower, planting seeds.
May the seeds
God has planted grow and blossom in us. God is the gatherer at harvest time.
God sees our potential
and uses it for the beloved community. God is the one who encourages us to grow.
God desires
us to build the reign of God on earth as it is in heaven. Come, worship God by living faithfully into God's desires for us.
Bear the Spirit's fruit,
flourish in God's love, and grow.
Mirings, the music of the spheres.
This
join in the gathering prayer. Let the light of your word shine into the darkness of our world, illuminating our choices, enlightening our actions, and empowering our service. Melt the hardness of our hearts, expanding our compassion, and enlarging the circle of our concern. We listen for your voice of peace and wait knowledge of your glory in the faith of Christ. Amen.
You may be seated. If there's any kids here, come join me on the steps. I have a question for you guys. If somebody is going to change the world, who do you think that somebody is going to be? Who do you think has the power to change the world? Got any ideas? None? I would think maybe like the president, or maybe the president of another country. Somebody with lots of power, right? That would make sense, right? Yeah? Well, I have a book today, and it tells a different story, okay? It's called Ordinary Mary's Extraordinary Deed. And we're going to start it, but it's kind of long, so we're going to flip through it real quick. Okay, I think you guys will catch on real quick. Ordinary Mary was so very ordinary that you'd never guess she could change the world. This ordinary kid, she did. She changed the world. One ordinary day, skipping on her way from her ordinary school to her ordinary house, she passed an ordinary vacant lot filled with ordinary bushes growing ordinary berries, ordinary blue and juicy, luscious, lovely blueberries. Do you guys like blueberries? Well, Ordinary Mary picked the ordinary berries and brought them in a big brown bowl to Miss Bishop's porch. What? She left the berries in a big brown bowl on Mrs. Bishop's porch. That sneaky kid. She did. Well, this made Mrs. Bishop very, very happy. So she baked a big batch of blueberry muffins and thought of five people who might have brought those beautiful berries, then secretly gave each a plate. How great! Five people got a plate of blueberry muffins. Would you guys be excited to get blueberry muffins? Yeah, would it make you really happy? Yeah. So, one of those five was her paper boy, Billy Parker. And when Billy saw his name on a plate in the driveway, and he quickly parked his bike and ate every crumb. This made him so glad that the next five people got their papers on the porch and not in the bushes, where he often threw them. In fact, they were handed right to the people. One of those five people was Mr. Morey, who was so amazed that he smiled for 10 hours on the airplane, then said to five different people who had heavy bags, "Here, let me help you." He still smiled, and they did too. So, Mr. Morey, we're going to skip ahead real quickly. Mr. Morey is really excited that somebody helped him. So he helps somebody with a cranky baby and plays peekaboo with them and helps four more people. Well, Mario is the dad of the baby and was so happy that he helped five more people. And then you end up with the little boy who shares an orange, and the shopkeeper gives a lady with a broken purse a new purse. And then the lady with the broken purse tells this woman that she has beautiful eyes that match her beautiful dress, and she stops crying and has a really good day. And she helps five more people. One of those people is the doctor. And the doctor is so happy. Oh, that's the mother of the doctor. She calls her son just to say, I love you and I hope you have a good day. And she talks to four other people. The doctor helps five people out. He gives balloons to kids that are sick in the hospital. And the kid with the balloons helps another kid who drops all of his stuff. And each person helps five people. Now, if every person helps five people, 14 times later, you want to take a guess at how many that is? So if we keep multiplying. So if you do five nice things to somebody else, each of those five people do five nice things, those 25 people do five nice things, you get 125. If each of those 125 people do five nice things for people, 14 times, we get 30 billion, 517 million. There's too many commas, I can't get this number right. 578,125. Do you know how many people are in the world? Do you think they know how many people are in the world? Who knows? 7.5 billion people in the world. So, when we start doing, getting to this number, every single person has at least three nice things done to them. Do you think that would change the world? I think that would change the world. And all it took was one kid picking regular blueberries and giving them to somebody who would enjoy them. That's pretty cool, isn't it? Do you guys think you can do five nice things? I mean, you guys can play peekaboo with babies, right? Open doors, smile at people, say I love you. You can do a lot of the things that were done in this book, can't you? You can. Do you think that all the people out there could do five nice things? Yeah? So let's say we're going to do an easy round number for my mathematics. Say we have 50 people here today, and we each do five nice things today. Five times five is 25, 250. I'm getting head nods. 250 people's lives would be changed just by the people here today. That would be pretty cool, wouldn't it? It would be. I think we should take that challenge. Yeah? Okay. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for ordinary people and help us to care for others and change the world. Amen. Thank you for listening to my story today.
us and save, e'en in the darkness of the grave. Still more in resurrection light, we read the fullness of your might. O love of God, our shield and stay, through all the perils of our way, eternal
Scriptures this morning come from the book, first book of Samuel, starting with chapter 15, verse 34, and continuing through 16, verse 13. Then Samuel went to Ramah, and Saul went up to his house in Gibeah of Saul. Samuel did not see Saul again until the day of his death, but Samuel grieved over Saul. And the Lord was sorry that he had made Saul king over Israel. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul? I have rejected him from being king over Israel. Fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears of it, he will kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do, and you shall anoint for me the one who I name for you, to you." Samuel did what the Lord commanded and came to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him trembling and said, "Do you come peaceably?" He said, "Peaceably. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice." And he sanctified Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they came, he looked on Eliab and thought, "Surely his anointed is now before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord does not see as mortals see. The Lord looks on the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. He said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Then Jesse made Shammah pass by, and he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel, and Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen any of these." Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all your sons here?" And he said, "There remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send him, bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." He sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. The Lord said, "Rise and anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers, and the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. Samuel then set out and went to Ramah. This is the word of the Lord.
The story of King David is a well-known story in the Christian faith. It is a beautiful story that reminds us not to judge a book by its cover, right? Well, as I was reading it, I decided I would go back and read the 8 chapters that we skipped since last week. What is it in this story that we have missed? Because last week, the people were demanding a king, right? And finally, God says, "Give him a king." And that's where we end. And all of a sudden, God is rejecting the king that was chosen and anointing a new one. Something major has obviously happened. And as I went back and read, it gave me some new insights into this story of King David. So, Old Testament, it gets a bit gory. So bear with me. Luckily, the children have left. But, so, the people are told they're going to get a king, right? And Saul is anointed the king. And Saul is described as coming from a wealthy family. His father has a lot of money. He is described as being very handsome. And then the next verse says that there was no Israelite more handsome than him. So doubly handsome. And he was head and shoulders taller than anybody else. So he's tall, really handsome, and has lots of money. Perfect man to be the king, right? Well, he is anointed to be king. Samuel anoints him, and then he kind of goes on. It's this little kind of private anointing kind of a thing. And then all of a sudden, this word comes that the people in Jabesh are having, the males are having their right eyes gouged out by the Ammonites. And so they're pleading for somebody to come and to help them. So Saul heads on off with his little army to go save the people of Jabesh, and he does. And the people are so thankful and they are so excited that they renew the kingship. So now he's not just anointed by Samuel, the prophet from God, but the people are behind him and they support him and they are recognizing this kingship on their own. So from here they go out and there's all these battles, lots of more battles. And there's one of these moments when Saul is supposed to meet Samuel, and in 7 days, when they meet at this place, they will do a burnt offering together. Samuel doesn't show up on time. Saul's feeling really pressured. It needs to happen now, and he does it on his own. So he kind of gets his hand slapped. Don't do this again. God is telling you, you need to follow the commandment that is given to you. Be aware. Well, time goes on, and there's all of these other battles, lots and lots of battles. And we get to this time. We're going to skip the whole Jonathan stories because I got no insight in from Jonathan. But We get to another battle with the Amalekites, in which Saul shows up and tells the Kenites that are there. He says, God has sent me to destroy the Amalekites because when the people came out of Egypt, they were mean. But you, the Kenites, showed kindness to the Israelites. So you will be spared if you leave the city. So leave. And so, Saul has been given directions to destroy every living thing. Every living thing is to be destroyed. That is his instruction from God. Saul goes in, wins the battle, destroys the Amalekites. But the people are kind of going, but you know what? They have some really good cattle. They got some really nice sheep. These would be really nice. And so Saul gives in and says, okay, we can keep those. We'll keep the cows, we'll keep the sheep, we'll keep all of the good stuff and destroy the rest of all the living things. So Samuel comes and says, hey, you didn't follow your instructions. You didn't do what you were told again. And his reply is, well, I kept them so I could do a burnt offering to God. I was doing this for God. I improved God's store or God's plan, and I'm going to do something even better for God. As you read the story, he's not really regretful of what he did. He kind of says, come on, Samuel, let's come over here. We're going to go do a burnt offering together to your God. Not my God, not our God, but let's do a burnt offering to your God. Come on, show the people you're on my side. Let's celebrate the win because everybody's happy. Come with me. And Samuel says, no, God has left you. God's spirit has left you. Samuel goes his way, and Saul goes his. And this, oh, I forgot to tell you that because they also saved the king, Samuel cut him into pieces. So, as he now shows up to the family of David, you can understand why they say, are you here peacefully or not? So, that is the background of where we are as we enter into this story. You've got people wondering, why is Samuel here? What is going on? Because his last encounter, not the most exciting for some people. Scary, actually, if you think about it. And so the people are wondering, what's going to happen? And so Samuel goes on to continue to share the word of God, to say, there is somebody out there whose heart is aligned with God's. And as I thought about the story of Saul and this idea of why it was that God was so angry with him, I don't think it has anything to do with if he followed the exact instructions or not. Is it because he followed the commandment? Or is it because his heart wasn't with God? Saul's heart was with the people. Saul says to Samuel, let's do a burnt offering to your God. This wasn't his God, it was Samuel's God. Saul's heart was with the people. He was making the people happy. He was keeping his power, he was keeping his kingship. He was doing what the people wanted him to do. That was Saul's struggle with God. It wasn't because he disobeyed the commandment, but because his heart was not with God. He wouldn't open his heart to God. So now, Samuel moves on and says, it's time for a new king. It's time to anoint the next king, which there is a big difference. Of course, as we are all thinking about the anointing of a king, we think of this tall, handsome, rich man, right? This Saul figure. And instead, we get a poor boy who is from a family that are sheep herders. You don't get any lower than sheep herders. It doesn't happen. They are the poorest of the poor. To be lower than a sheep herder, you would have leprosy or something that kept you out of the community. They were sheep herders. He wasn't the oldest. Things go to the oldest child. It should have been Eliab. But it wasn't Eliab, or the next one, or the next one. But a boy. A young boy. Now our gospel reading for the day is the story of the mustard seed. So this idea that from the tiniest little seed comes this great thing. The tiniest little seed. But anybody who has had a garden or a farm knows, when you plant a seed, how long does it take to get something? Long time. And if you're talking about this great big thing, years. So it's this idea that from these tiny little things come great big amazing things, but oftentimes it takes time. So, the anointing of David isn't about him taking the kingship today and being great today. It will take years. It will take decades before we get to him being king and being great. It will take a long, long time. So often we want things immediately and now. We look for what people have right now that can fix a problem, instead of helping people to grow and to flourish and allowing things to unfold and grow as they may. And I thought, not only is this about people, but this is about churches. So often we think that as a church, we need to be the big mega church, that numbers matter. And if we don't have so many numbers, we're not as great of a church. And I would disagree. One of the things that you don't hear about the large mega churches is that the average person stays at a mega church for 18 months. They don't stay. They have all of this turnover. There's flash and excitement and large budgets and all kinds of things. But what they don't have are connections. When you walk into a church like ours, you know faces. You know how each other are doing. You know when somebody's in the hospital and when somebody needs a smile or a hug. Or a congratulations, we're excited to celebrate with you. Something you don't get when you add too many people. There is a purpose for smaller things. Smaller churches like ours make bigger difference in each of our lives and can fill needs in the community where other churches can't. Oftentimes, it takes time, it takes patience, and our hearts need to be with God. Not on numbers, not on making people happy, but our hearts need to be with God. So, As we hear in the story of Samuel, don't judge a book by its cover, but know that over time, each of us can make a difference, a world of difference in this world. The people around us being encouraged and supported can make a world of difference in this world if our hearts are with God. Amen. You to join with me in a time of prayer. Oh God, we gather together, coming in the hopes of opening our hearts and our minds and our ears to you. We desire to be your people, your hands and your feet, your hope and your joy and your love in this world. God, help us to keep our hearts turned towards you and the courage to fulfill what you call us to do in this world. God, this morning, we thank you for the men in our lives that have encouraged us, supported us, taught us to love you and the importance of caring for one another. God, we ask that you be with our fathers, that they may know that they are loved and their love is appreciated. God, be with those who are grieving their own fathers. Fathers that were good fathers and have departed this world, or grieved an absent father. God, we ask that you be with the men who desire to be fathers and are not yet one. Be with each of us that we find ways to show our fathers and our male role models appreciation and love. God, this morning, we ask for special prayers to be with Donna and Dwayne, Elizabeth, Sherry, Kathy, and Gloria. And God, we pray with and for the country of Germany. We pray that you help grow the small seed again and that it develops and creates a home for hope, peace, comfort, and love. Help to teach a young generation about the memories of the past. Help to connect the next generation to ecumenical partners of their age and other countries. Help organize new exchanges for young people about global problems, fears, hopes, and worldwide justice. Help to pass the insights of the last 75 years into the future. The small seed will grow again and again to provide shelter for bright, diverse, and colorful expressions of life. And together we pray that prayer which you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our worth is not our belongings, but in our benevolence, in passing on God's providence more than in possessing the products of our labor. We find our true identity. So let us give, therefore, because this act benefits us as well as those who we will help. So let us give because the God who has blessed us is honored through our offerings. If you would like to support the mission and ministries of St. John's, you can put your offering in the plates as they come around. There's a number you can text or you can donate online as well. We thank you for not just your offerings, but also your time and your talents.
standing as we join together in the prayer of dedication. O God, make our sacrifices of thanksgiving and grateful response into instruments of your purposes, for we could be consecrated along with our gifts. Remember all our offerings with your favor, that they may serve your purpose for your creation. Amen.
Into the world with eyes to see the needs of others, with ears to hear their cries of both joy and sorrow, with hands that are ready to give, for you go in the power of God to the children of God. And as you go, may God surround you with love, Jesus Christ fill you with peace, and the Holy Spirit lead you in hope. Amen.